Welcome back to the. Pietro, scusa, chiudi la. So, welcome back to the hands-on session. Sorry to be late for starting this session. So, now Pietro De Lucas will give us an introduction in terms of computation. So, he will explain how we can exploit Espresso and in order to evaluate magnetic properties and focusing on magnetic non-states. So, Pietro, please, the floor is yours.
Greetings to everybody. And this is to everybody. And let me first thank all the tutors: Sutanya Ghosh, Nanda Kumar Velankani, Subramanya Sapatiti and Nei Chiao, Alessandro Stroppa, and above all, also first of all, also a person that I forgot to mention in the first slide in the presentation, Yunihiro Kanaoze, the collaborator of Alessandro that helped us to prepare the exercises and test them and. So these exercises also are also his own work. So as the title says, we will keep this tutorial quite simple. So we'll just study the magnetism in simple materials that we need the transition metals. We concentrate mostly on iron, and then we study also the properties of cobalt and nickel. We will do first exercise will be the comparison of the magnetic and non-magnetic solution for iron in BCC phase. And then we will do a further exercise where we always on iron, we will study the dependence of the exchange splitting on the lattice constant. A third exercise will instead regard the comparison of the occupation of the 3D levels in the transition metals. So in iron, cobalt, and nickel. And as a fourth exercise, I will show you how to compute how to compute the bands in a magnetic material, both in the collinear and the non-collinear case. But these cases will regard actually nickel, that is a material that has no effect from the spin orbit coupling, so that let's say that the exercise is a little bit trivial, but at least it helps you to understand how you can extract and plot the spin properties of the bands when you are plotting them. So to avoid the problems, the exercises are not very, very heavy, so they can also be run in the virtual machine. But in my cases, I'm running Zoom, I experienced that running Zoom together with Quantum Espresso is quite heavy, so I will execute the exercises in the HPC cluster, and I just added here the slides of Tone about the execution in the remote machine. So we will use mostly remote MPI run, remote MPI run. And then you already know how to use that. So it's remote MPI run, name of the program, minus in, name of the input file. And just that. Then we will use remote batch because we are going to submit a couple of scripts. In this case, I just remember one thing that in your if you are going to use the cluster, you can take advantage of the fact that you have many processors, and before launching the script, it's better if you edit it and you increase the key point parallelism and put there n minus nk10 like here, because in that way you will be able to run faster on the cluster, exploiting more the possibility to compute the Miltonian blocks for each key point in parallel instead than in serial. And then we will also use, if we are going to use the cluster. We are also using, we will also be using in intensively the rsync from HPC command to recover the data in order to do the plots and to do the elaboration on the virtual machine. Okay, the first exercise is to task of the first, the object of the first exercise is to compare the magnetic and the magnetic solution for iron in the BCC phase. There is the first part of the exercise where you where we just for each for both for the magnetic and for the non-magnetic phase we optimize the lattice constant. So we scan the lattice constant from 4.6 bars to 5.9 bars. We find the and with then we use ev.x as you have already used in the third in the day three to fit with the Marnedam equation of state the energies that we have obtained, and with these energies to find the optimized lattice constant. Okay, we have after we have done this, we will obtain a result like this, that obviously as iron is a magnetic material, you will find that magnetic solution will have a lower ground state with respect to the non-magnetic solution. And you also will notice that the lattice constant of the magnetic solution is larger than the one of the non-magnetic one. In this first exercise, we are using LSDA. So the other thing that you have to notice is that actually LSDA underestimates the lattice constant of the material. So you instead of having a value that is 5.4 bars as you have in the experiment, you will have 5.2 bars. And as we see in the second exercise, the lattice constant is very important for magnetic materials. Okay. Few remarks on the inputs that we are using. Okay, the first remark is that we are going to activate the magnetic solution. How do we activate the magnetic solution? It is using these two control variables. The first one is n spin that can have values one or two. With one, you are using non-polarized LDA, so you have that all the constant states are assumed to be degenerate for spin, so you just compute them once. While instead with n spin two, you instruct the code to assume that the constant states may be non-degenerate. The second instruction is also important, it tells the code that the start instructs about the starting magnetization of the iron ion. This instructs that the starting potential is created assuming an initial magnetization on the iron that is of 0.3 times the charge of the iron ion. Okay, in this case, for this potential, the valence charge of the iron is 16, so it will be 0.3 times 16, for example. This is the case. This is the collinear case. In case you want to do the same calculation using the non-collinear formulas, then in that case, instead of using the spin variables, you have to use the non-collinear variable, and you have to set it to true. In this case, the code assumes that you are using the non-collinear formulas. And then to instruct the program that you want to use, that you want to look for a magnetic solution, you have to specify the starting magnetization of the system, so 0.3. But as the magnetization is now a vector, you have also to specify a direction of the magnetization. In this case, we are using the default values, which is angle 1 equals 0 and angle 1 equals 0. The first angle is the polar angle, is the angle that measures the difference, is the angle between the z axis and the magnetization. The second angle instead is the angle that is the azimuthal angle that gives you the angle between the projection of the magnetization in the xy axis and the x direction. Okay, the second thing that we are going to inspect the output of PW in order to understand what if the system is magnetized and what how much is the magnetization. This is printed in the spin polarized case. The magnetization is printed at each CF step. It is printed as a scalar as it is. So you have a value that is in Bohr. This is the Bohr magnetos per cell. And it prints two values. The first value is the total magnetization. So it's the magnetization with a sign. The second one is the absolute magnetization. That instead is the integral of the absolute value of the magnetization at each point integrated. The fact that the two are different, it means that in some points of the density, the magnetization is negative instead of positive. If you are doing the same calculation in the magnetic non-collinear case, the magnetization is printed as a vector. In this case, I initialized the magnetization with an angle of 45 degrees. And as you see, part of the angle one equal to 45 degrees. And as you see now, the magnetization points in part in the y direction and in part in the x direction. As the angle is 45 degrees, the two components are equal. Together with the total magnetization at the end of the computation, the code also prints an estimate of the magnetization at each ionic site. This is presented in this way. You have for each atom, you have the magnetization integrated inside the sphere of radius r. The radius r here is given in a lot units. So this 0.36 must be multiplied times the value of the lattice constant, in this case, 5.2 or 5.4, gives you the value of the total charge and gives you the value of the magnetization. This is also printed in the non-magnetic non-collinear case. And again, in this case, the value is also printed as a vector, as before. Okay, now let's see the first exercise. Just go to QE 2021, A7. And exercise one, magnetic versus antiferromagnetic. Okay, here you have two directories, magnetic and non-magnetic. We just first use the non-magnetic directory. Yeah, here you find a script. You find two scripts. You can choose whether to use job SH script or if you want to use the PWTK script. In this case, let me just submit the batch script. It will run for about 50 seconds and then we'll stop. Okay, sorry, it seems that I forgot to do what I just told you to do. So yeah, for example, now I'm running it with two key points. Instead, when you run it on the cluster, it's much better to run it with 10 key points. And okay, now it started, so it's a topic. Okay, it has finished. Just for okay, we are running late, so it would be worth to see how with 10 key points it's much faster. But now, in any case, when the file is okay, the script has created an energies.dat file that is in the remote machine. Let me just retrieve it with the command. So now we have recorded this file that just has the lattice constants and the total energies for each solution. We now use heavy.x to compute the optimized lattice constant. So we are using Bohr, so atomic units. The system is a BCC system. We are using the Murnaghan equation of state. The input file is energies.dat. The output file, let's call it ev.out in the instructions. So now we have obtained this file, ev.out. And what we are interested in this case, just the lattice constant that we find here. Sorry. It is 5.107 bors. Okay, now we do the same exercise for the magnetics, for the magnetic solution. In this case, I don't forget to set here the 10 key points. And then I submit the script. I check if it's finished or not. It has finished. No, it's not finished yet. It's running. Okay, strangely, it's taking a lot of time, and I understand why. There's some problem in the cluster. Okay, now it's finished, so I just record the file. And again, we just run a v.x as before. Okay. Just mistyped the name of the file just to be. And afterwards, I just rename it with the right name. And okay, now we can open it and see that now the lattice constant is 5.196 instead of bors, instead of 5.7. We can go in the app directory where we have a script called compare.gp that allows us to print and make the plot that you have in the slides. And just to make the comparison. Okay, now we have to study the electronic structure of the two systems, of the two solutions, and at the equilibrium lattice constants. So we go to the non-magnetic directory first, and then we go to the conv directory. Here you will find few input files. The first one that we are going to use is scf.in. That is the it is the input file for the non-magnetic solution. But just notice that here, when I've defined the system, I'm using and spin equal to. So I'm telling the program to assume that Kohn-Sham states are not in principle. Are not in principle spin degenerate, so it will compute them separately. But when I specify the starting magnetization, I set the value of 0.0, and this creates a completely symmetric starting potential. This symmetry is conserved. Is conserved during all the self-consistency calculation, and we will end up with a zero magnetization, as you can see there. Just run the script now. Okay. Oh. It's too long. So it's remote MPI run. Doing this for the sake of clarity. Remote MPI run, pw.x minus nk10.
Sorry, Pietro.
Yes.
From the streaming is quite slow, so they cannot follow you.
Ah, okay.
So you should slow down and step by step, and even repeating the steps because there is some delay or something. Thank you.
Okay. So we are now computing the non-magnetic solution. We are not doing the analysis of the electronic structure of the non-magnetic solution. We are doing the analysis of the let me repeat again what I said about the input file. So we have the input file. As I was saying, this is the non-magnetic solution, but when I specify the input, I specify and spin equal to. So I'm telling the program to compute to assume that the Kohn-Sham states are not spin degenerate. But I specify a starting magnetization of zero for the iron, and this starts the simulation with a symmetric potential. This symmetry is conserved during all the calculation, and what we get is that we obtain a non-magnetic solution. We are now in the we have come in the directory that is called we are in day 7, exercise 1, ferromagnetic versus non-magnetic conv directory, where you can find the input files. Now I just run the input file for the self-consistent calculation. W.x minus nk10. I just specified 10 key points because we are running on the cluster, so we are running with 20 processors. And then I specify the input. Like this. So, job has been submitted. it has already finished in this case. It recovered the file from the HPC cluster. So it's called fefescf.out. Okay, now we look at the file. Okay, what we are interested in is the final magnetization. And what we find is the total magnetization, as we expected, is zero. And also it's zero, the absolute magnetization. So there are no oscillation of the magnetization at any point in the file. One easy way to get the magnetization without browsing all the files is using the grep command. And you get all the values of total magnetization during the SCF consistent loop. Okay. Now that we have obtained our charge density, we want to make an analysis of the electronic structure. So what we are going to do is to compute the density of states. Okay, at this point, as we know, the first thing that we have to do is to compute, to perform a non-self-consistent calculation like this, where we we just specify calculation and SCF, so the calculation is not self-consistent. Then other things that I changed in the file are the occupations. Occupations, as we are going to use this run for computing the density of states, I specify the occupation as the trihedra OPT instead of leading, because in this case, the values, in this case, it won't use the integration because this is a non-self-consistent calculation, but it will pass this option to the DOS program that will use this option to integrate the density of states. The other thing that I've done is to increase the key points mesh in order to have a more a better quality for the DOS that we are going to print out. So now we run this file as the one before, important geran dw.px minus sk10. And here we just specify the new input file and submit the run. The run is gone. So we just now check if the job is concluded. Yes, so we can recover the file. Okay, now we don't need the output file. Okay, we don't need this output file because it's just the electronic structure. What the electronic structure will be used by the DOS program. So what you are going to do now is to execute remotely also the DOS command. Even if the DOS command is quite light, so there will be no need to execute it in the remote machine. The DOS command uses files that have been saved in the scratch directory. So there are a lot of files that are in the scratch directory. In this case, there is a file that is in the scratch directory that I can also recover. It's not there because it's in the scratch directory. We don't need the XML file now. If you want to look at the XML file, you can go to the remote cluster and check it from there. Okay, now instead we'll execute DOS command, remote, okay, run, DOS.x. Okay, we will just use one processor to avoid tissue. We are using the fed.in input file. So now the job has been submitted. In the meantime, that it runs, we just look at the input file. The input file is pretty simple. As you can see, there are just three lines. The first line is the prefix that tells which is the prefix, what is the prefix of the previous run, and so where the program has to look for the files. The second flag is fill DOS. So fill DOS is the variable that specifies to DOS.x the name of the file where to print the density of states. And then we are specifying the minimum energy, maximum energy, and the step of the energy on which to compute the DOS. Obviously, these values are the values that I have selected in because I want to zoom in the region of the eigenvalues that I'm interested in. But we can obviously one cannot know it in advance. So what one can do is to before running the file.
Sorry, Pietro. Again. Please slow down because some people, you know, are very new in this topic and there are some difficulty to follow.
I was saying, we are using the fe.in files, that is this one. To open it, you can use vi, less any command that you want, and to look inside it, any editor that you want. And there are three lines. It's pretty simple. So there's a prefix, there is the name of the file, fed.dos, and then there are these three values. It is the minimum value of the energy, the maximum value of the energy. It is the range in which the DOS will be computed. And then there is a value that tie, that is the value that is the step at which the DOS, the density of states is computed. Density of states is the it's a number for each energy you compute the values, the states up to energy plus delta E minus the values of states for energy at energy and divided by delta E. So it's a derivative of the total number of states as a function of the energy. The smaller is this value, the more qualitatively the better is the density of states. But obviously, you need a larger density of key points as delta e becomes smaller. And as I was saying, for selecting the range at the beginning, you don't know what is the best range for you. So what you can do is to edit this file, just avoid to specify the minimum and the maximum value. Specify a value for the delta E that is not that small, but also a large value is okay because you are just for a small inspection of the DOS. Okay, we now call it fpreDOS just to overwrite the file that we have already written. And now we can also submit this file again, this computation again. Yeah, submitted the file. In the meantime, I recovered the our good DOS, this one. So if we so So also, you can also recover now here we have a program here we have a new plot script to plot DOS. Let's first plot the DOS of this is not what I was expecting actually. Yes, it's originally okay. Okay, there's been an issue in the remote machine, sorry, and so I'm adding the wrong file.
So you are in non-magnetic converge.
Yes, okay, I will okay, we'll show you the this one. It is really, really a bad one, but sorry, okay, seems that 400 gigas are not enough. So, let me make it a message. So, I am reading on the Slack channel that somebody has problems with the disk is full in the remote machine, so it's okay, we can solve that afterwards.
Do you have the reference?
Yes, I have the reference because probably it's better to show the reference.
So maybe you can recap what we are doing now and just show this reference file.
Yeah, okay, so I'm here. And now we have. Let me check one. So ecco, yeah, okay. So the problem that for my okay, maybe I don't have time. So I made a mistake when I submitted the job for the non-self-consistent calculation. The job for non-self-consistent calculation failed. I didn't notice that. I didn't check for that. And so the DOS that I obtained here is a DOS that is obtained from the eigenvalues of the self-consistent calculation. So it's for that reason it's not of high quality. But what we have done here is first we have run. First we have run the self-consistent calculation. Then we have run the non-self-consistent calculation.
So there are some comments on the Zoom chat. Can you see that?
Yes, sorry. You need to do the Git pull. You need to, obviously, yes, because I changed the, there was a problem in the scripts that I changed, and you need to do Git pull. Otherwise, it's not working.
No, the last comments just for the submission process.
I don't see them on the chat or on the chat. Sorry.
So the number of
it's my fault. Yes, that means me that minus and k equal 10, otherwise it doesn't work.
Pietro, minus nk 10 after the pw.x.
I'm messing up everything, yeah. Thanks, Don. And so okay, I've HPC. Now the job succeeded. So if we run those commands, if we run the ROS command, then we can then okay, in the meantime, now it's running the DOS command with the modified file. So it's creating a file that is called fi_pre.dos, and this using all the range of eigen value, all the range of eigen values that he finds, and is doing that with a file mesh. We now just modify it, prepare it to run instead our the calculation for the file mesh in this way. We save the file and we check that if it's finished or not. It's not finished. Okay, the DOS command usually there are a lot of key points, so it takes a lot of time actually. And
so Pietro, they are asking why did you change the file iron.dos?
Okay. What I was saying is this: that we have the, this is the DOS. This is the command for the DOS for the DOS input. As you can see, when you do a DOS, you are not interested in all the range. You are just interested in a range of where that you want to study, that you want to see in detail. And as doing the DOS actually takes a lot of time because the range of eigenvalues is very large, as you can see now because it's running, it's better to make first a calculation with a density of states that is in all the range in order to see what is the range that you're interested in, and doing that with the value of the delta E that is not that large in order that it doesn't compute too many integrals, because for each value between a mean and the max, and that is it divides this value by delta E. So for each value in this range that is enters in this division, it computes an integral. So the integral is cost is expensive computationally. So the less you compute, the better it is. So it's better to have a shorter range, but to have a good quality DOS, you also want to have a very small delta E, or the, okay, a delta E that is small enough. So the first run that I, the first, okay, this is the one that we are doing using for the exercise, where we have the range that is defined in order that it goes from that just encloses the 3D shell, while instead we are neglecting all the other shells. Well, instead, the job that I just ran, it was just for demonstration, it was not part of the exercises actually, but it was just to show you one thing. This is the one that is created now, but so you just type remote from HPC, then the name of the file, the FEPRE one. You get this file. Okay. Now we use, we use the script to. But this part I will just do it for demonstration. There is no need that you do it because I understand that using VI for one that is not familiar is not exactly comfortable, and I actually not comfortable with other editors. So, here the script has been created to plot FEDOS, but we want to plot instead FEDOS, and so we just put it here like this. And then we just plot the, we just use the command. So we have also to comment this line, otherwise obviously it won't work. So as you can see, if you plot all the range, you have also the semi-core states that are very far from what you're interested. You are just interested instead of the range that goes from here to here. So and this range is what we want to plot better. And as you can see here, there are the S and P states that are very far from the states. It's also important to say that these states are very far in energy and don't influence the magnetism of the system because they are very far. So now we submit the run for the right DOS. So the DOS that is included between 5 and 25 and with a fine delta E in order to have a fine mesh. And we, in the meantime, remodify the script in order, okay. Remodify the script in order that it plots the right range in the right file. So we recovered the file from this cluster. Now, let's open. I was retrieving the wrong file. So let's open the file with DOS, file.dos. This is the file fe.dos. The format of the file is like this. There are a column with the energies, a column with the density of states for the up channel, a column for the density for the down channel. Then there is another column with the integral of the density of states, total, dos up plus dos down. So this is to sum up to the number of the electrons. In the first line, there is also the information about the value of the Fermi energy. That is this one. And so the value is 25.3445. And we want to add this value here. Okay, it was already set. So we just go and use the plot command. Okay, now fortunately now we have obtained the right density of states. So as you can see, the up and down channel are completely symmetric, and the eigen values are equal for the up and down channel. And that's it. Okay. Now we go to exercise one, ferromagnetic versus non-magnetic file. Then from there we move to the magnetic directory, and inside the magnetic directory we go to the comp file. Here again, we have the files that are necessary for computing the electronic structure. We have the fel.cf.in, which is equal to the one before. The only difference is that now, it is that now the lattice constant is not the one of the, it's lattice constant, the equilibrium is the optimized one for the magnetic structure. The other thing is that now the starting magnetization is different from zero, it's 0.26 in this case. And so we just, as before, run the self-consistent calculation. Again, remote MPI run, pw.x, this is the remote execution. pw.x is the program, minus nk10 instructs the program to use 10, the parallelization of key points to 10. Probably you will hear about these options the day after, on day nine, when we get HPC day, where the parallelization options will be explained better. And then we specify the input, which is again fesf13. We just commit the script. It it goes, it's running. Check the status of the program. Okay, it has finished, so now we can recover the output, even to check that the execution terminated regularly, because as we have seen, it's better always to check. So we recover the file that is fesef.out from the remote machine. Now we open the file with and we go to the end of the file. You can scroll it fast in any way. So you check that the file has been completed, and you check the total magnetization, and you can see now the total magnetization is different from zero. It's 1.96, it is the magnetization of the system. In this case, so now again, we can run the as before the so now again, after you have run the self-consistent calculation, you can run the non-self-consistent calculation with the finite mesh. And so it's again remote MPI run, name of the program pw.x minus nk10 to increase the key point mesh, minus nk10, the number of the input. And then you just submit.
Sorry, Pietro, there are several seconds of delay on the streaming. So you really need to have.
But on the okay.
Because then you type and you say something, but.
It's not in the same. Okay, so.
No, it's like 5-6 seconds after. So awesome. You really have to be quite slow. Thank you.
Okay. So now we have run the non-self-consistent calculation. We want to check the status of the calculation. Okay, this is only for the people that is running in the HPC cluster, actually. So you can, this is not something that one does usually. So we check the calculation has finished. So now we recover the file. So it's rsync from HPC, the name of the file. Okay, now we open the file. The file is called nschf.out. We open it. We scroll to see that it ended regularly. Okay, the file ended regularly. There we have the Fermi energy of 20.0.44. But now we are able to run the DOS command. We will not do the same procedure as before. If we open the DOS command, you can see that the DOS command. For some reason, the DOS command is not here, but we can actually copy it. Okay, probably there is a problem that the DOS command, the DOS script is not here, but the DOS script is practically the same that you had for the non-magnetic solution. So what I'm doing now is just to copy that file here. I didn't realize that it was not here. I don't know whether it's a problem of my virtual machine or it's a problem of a problem in over the virtual machine. Okay. So now we run. Okay, in the NSCF calculation, the flag, I think it's the same. Okay, there was a question from Slack. Starting magnetization here, it doesn't, okay, here the value is 0.7, but it doesn't matter because it's not used. This is a non-self-consistent calculation. What the program does is to read the potential, to read the charge density from the file. And after it reads the potential from the file, it initializes the potential from that charge density. So it's not using this information, but actually, yes, it's different from the one in the SCF file, but this one doesn't add because it's not used by the program, even if it's always better if there are no contradictions between the inputs. But in this case, I changed it. And I forgot to commit the change here. So So we are running the DOS now. Now we are running the density of state calculation for the magnetic solution. Okay, the calculation is finished, so we can so now we open the DOS file here. We see that the density of states is 20.0244. The format is the same as before, but okay. Again, there is a small. There's another file that I forgot to commit in this machine. So it's. Okay, there is a problem with the file that I can't find, but just copy again the script from the non-magnetic conf directory, like I'm doing. So we are in the magnetic conf directory, and we do cp dot dot slash dot dot slash non-magnetic conf plot those non-magnetic and we plot here in plot. Sorry. Let me copy it here. And then we move the file in plot those non-magnetic to plot those magnetic. So the file is now that I copied the file is the same, obviously, but we need to edit the Fermi level. We reopen the DOS file. You see that the Fermi level now is 20.0.44. Yes, the problem is that I set everything to run one after the other. If you run them, this is for Pavle Nikacevic on Black. If you run them together, there is an issue because I've been using the same prefix. And if you use the same prefix, obviously they are using the same scratch, the same temporary directory and yes, you're reading the wrong density, the wrong eigenvalues, then the wrong density. You computed wrong density of states. So you need to first run one and then the other. So okay, we just copy this value here. And put it in this file here in the script. In this way. Now we can plot the dots. And then you can see now in this case you have that the majority channel and the minority channel are different. In particular, there is, okay, the shape of the density of states is more or less analogous, and it's possible to identify, let's say, the peaks relative to the EG states, which is this one. The same peak, the peak is here and the peak is here. There was a question during the lecture this morning and relative to the Stoner model and how one can identify exactly the exchange splitting. It's not so easy to identify. I mean, it's not so, there is not a rigorous recipe to identify it because obviously the majority channel and the minority channel have different Hamiltonians. So in principle, they can have completely different shape of density of states. But usually when there is an evident feature relative to a particular state, like in this case, this peak is due to the EG states of about which Alessandro was talking during the talk. So the iron has the d orbitals. The d orbitals are split in the t2g states that have a more wide band, and the eg states that instead show a sharp peak like this one. So one way to evaluate the exchange splitting in iron is to measure the difference in energy between these two peaks. Okay, the peak of the majority channel is below the Fermi level, as you can see, and while instead the peak of the minority channel is over the Fermi level. So this is occupied and this is unoccupied. And this creates the magnetization of the system. If we then measure the difference, okay, if you are using GNU plot, you can see that you have on the bottom left an indication of the coordinates. So you just pick a value here with the pointer, you read the value there, you read the value of the x coordinate, that is in this case is minus 0.7, for example. Then you pick the value of the x coordinate for the peak of the minority channel, that is 1.5. And we get that we have minus 1.5 plus 0.7 makes the value of 2.2. That is the value that we indicated, that the value of the is our estimate of the exchange splitting in iron, and is of 2.2. Sometimes, okay, here is iron. It is an elemental metal, so it's pretty easy to see the features of the d orbitals. In other cases, it may be a little bit more difficult, because these are mixed with other features. And in this case, it helps, instead of using the dose, instead of computing the total dose, to compute the projected density of states. And to do this, we use a program that is called ProjWFC. So we just run it. Okay, we have here another input. We open the input. FEPDOS.in. Okay, the input here in this case is even simpler, because it's just two lines. The first one is the prefix that I was saying is the one that defines where the program has to look for the for the eigenvalues. And actually, yes, it would have been better to have a different name for the magnetic and non-magnetic structure, so that one can run the two independently. And then you have the same range of energies that we had for the density of states and the same delta E. So now we run the now we run the command, so it's proj.wfc.x minus input feddos.in. We run the program, we submit the program. It has been submitted. Check if it's running. Okay, it has finished, so we can. Okay, in this case, the program creates in this case, the program creates more than one file. So we are interested in various files that we want to recover, to retrieve from the remote. So it's we want to retrieve, first of all, the output. We open the output and see how it's done. So there are some information, then just tells you something. Okay. There was an error. Sorry, I forgot. Program doesn't run if you don't specify that you want only 8 processors. So just n prop equal 8. To run, you have to run it like this. time, you just recover the file again as before. Okay, this is the output of the file. The file specifies the atomic states on which the program is projecting your wave functions. So there are 13 atomic states. There are two for the 2s semi-core states, two for the 2p semi-cores, and there are six for the p states, because there are 2p projectors on two atomic states, and then there are the projectors on the d states. Sorry. That we are interested in too. And then the program prints the composition of which wave function for each key point on these atomic states. So it's just in this way. If you look at the end of the file, you also find the analysis of the loading charges. The analysis of the loading charges is important because it tells you the total charge for each atom. It tells you how much charge, the total charge of the atom. In this case, we have only one atom. So how much is the total of the loading charges on that atom? And it also tells you it decomposes it in according to the atomic orbitals. So you have that on the p orbitals, for example, on the d orbitals of the iron, for example, you have total charge on the up channel, you have 4.35, and this is decomposed in order that you have that the two t2g are the dz square and the dx square minus square. You have an occupation of 0.93, while instead the d orbitals, the t2g, these three, has a minor occupation. If you look at the instead of the minority channel, to the down channel, you see that the d occupation is much lower, is much lower, 2.3 about, and you see that the occupation, both the occupation of the AG and the T2G, is much smaller than the one of the T2G of the up channel. Okay. Now we want also to recover a set of files. So, if you are using the remote machine to recover all these files, you have to write a regular expression. So you write like this. You recover all the files that have this regular expression. Rsync from HPC, fe.pdos underscore ATM star. So you can see has recovered all these files that are all the projection of the projection, there are the files with the projection of each of the atomic states. As I was saying, then our pseudo potential for iron has two s states in balance, one semi-core, the 4s, and one in balance, the 5s. Same thing for the p orbitals. He has one as the 4p and as the 5p, and then we have the valence of the orbitals, this one. And this last one is the one that we want to inspect. So we just open the file this way. You need to pay attention because this file is written in a way that is weird to manage with the bash. So you have to enclose it in left and right apex in order to open it like this. And just increase the character, otherwise it's not possible to see anything. And you can see the file is organized in this way. That is the total energy. So there is the energy of there's the energy here. Here there is the total density of states for the up channel, the total in the sense that all the density of all the d orbitals, the density of states relative projected on all the d orbitals for the up channel. The total density of the total projected density of states for all the d orbitals on the down channel, and then you have the projection. Then you have the projection for each of the atomic wave functions. So you have okay. This one is better if I show you in the slide, maybe. So for the d orbital, we have other 10 columns. These 10 columns are the d orbital, are the projection of each of the atomic states. The order in which they are printed is this one. So you have first the dz squared, then you have the dz zx, then dzy, and then dx squared minus y squared. The xy, and okay, in this case we just plot the total. We have here a script that plots the total projection. So we just plot the column 2. We plot the column 2 and the column 3. Column 2 and column 3. The command is like this. As you can see, the contribution from SNP channels is very small. So the projection is practically the same as it was for the for the total density of states. This is the projected one. If you are interested in instead of just okay, you can actually edit this file and just check for example. Let's say that we want to see what is the density of state, the projected density of states on a G channel. So the as you were saying, so it's, for example, instead of column 2 here, we want to plot to column 4. And for the down channel, we want to plot column 5. We use again the script in this way. As you can see now, this is the projection only on the EG state. It's much more localized. So there is very small contribution. There is very small mixing between. There's very small density of states in this region, and you have only one peak. So you have a very localized peak for the EG on the up channel and the down channel. And this is why we can actually say that this is a good estimate for the exchange splitting. Okay. So so this exercise is more or less finished because that's what we wanted to see. I don't know how. Maybe I can just show you the second exercise is to see instead how the magnetization and the exchange splitting behaves when the lattice constant decreases. For this second exercise, we will not use anymore the LDA functional, but we'll move to the PBF functional that gives a more realistic value of the lattice constant. And as you will see in this exercise, the lattice constant matters. matters also for the magnetic properties. And the exercise follows the same steps as before. There is a script that determines the optimized lattice constant for the magnetic solution with the PBE. Then we use the EVX to estimate the optimized lattice constant as before, actually. And then we just the script in this case also takes note of the magnetization at each value of the lattice constant. And the assignment, so there is a part of the exercise I didn't plan to explain during this tutorial, is to compute the electronic structure at three different values of the lattice constant. So we have to do the same things that we have done in the first part, in the first exercise, doing by yourself and estimate the exchange split in this case. This is the result, actually. So you see that the magnetization decreases as we decrease the lattice constant. The decrease is regular, it's almost linear. And to run the second exercise, you have to move to day 7, exercise 2, dot value independence. And from here, move to the FEBCC directory. Here again, there is a script The script is more or less like. In some less with the mouse. It is more or less like the one that we used for the first exercise. The only difference is that at the end of the file, I extract the value of the magnetization constant and of the magnetization moment. And so they are put and they are written in two files. So just to run the exercise, it's pretty simple. So it's remote batch. Okay, here again. When we run calculation, we change from 2 to 10. So what I see here again, just to tell, we are run for those that are running in the cluster, we are using 20 processors. So yeah, in the cluster we'll be using 20 processors, and the best way to use these 20 processors is to specify the parallelization option minus NK10, because we have a lot of key points, so we can compute them all together, and the calculation in this way runs faster. Okay, we save the file. Submit the calculation with the remote batch. We wait for the calculation to finish. Yes, if you use the cluster, you need to set mproc equal to 8. I forgot to mention the first time, but I think I mentioned it afterwards. When you run the exercise 1, the projected density of states, it's better not to use all the processors. It's better to use only Request that the reservation is invalid means that you have not updated. This is an answer to Tim Bogels. If you are using the CISA cluster, most likely, and what you need to do is to run the command update CISA reservation name. Afterwards, you have to close the terminal and reopen it, and everything should work fine. Okay, now we can recover, we can get these two files, magnetization.txt. Can obtain the magnetization.dat file. And we can also get the other file that I created. And there are other two GNU plot scripts to plot these files. The first one is reservation.gp that just prints the same output that I've shown you in the slides. So you have that the magnetization decreases while the lattice constant decreases. And As I told you at the beginning of the tutorial, the program prints two files. One is the total magnetization. The other one is the magnetic moment per ion. Okay, in this case, obviously, there is only one ion, the iron ion. So the two will be very close. But actually, as the magnetization is integrated in the sphere, the magnetization relative to the iron may be a little bit different from the one from the total one. And if you want just to see it, just plot maximum of GP. No, that is completely wrong. It seems that the program failed to find the magnetic moment. Okay, so sorry, I don't understand why, but okay. Just forget about this last factor, so it's not mine. Okay, just. The values are these ones, so the values of the total magnetization. And. Yes, deep. So the second part of the exercise would be to create to study the electronic structure, but I think that I will leave this part to you if you want to do that. And so let's move fastly to exercise 3. Exercise 3 is more or less an exercise the exercise is pretty similar to what we have done for exercise 1. for exercise one and exercise two. We want to compute, we want to compare the magnetic properties of three different transition metals. So iron BCC, cobalt HCP, and nickel FCC. And I just run the exercise for one of the species. Let's say that I run the exercise for cobalt just for changing. And so the first step also in this case is to run self-consistent calculation. Let's recover the file. Let's open the file. Sorry. Again, I mistyped the command again, so sorry, and so I have to retype the command again. Okay, if the calculations has finished, this is for Samira Bukachabia. If the calculations have terminated, you don't need to cancel the results from the HPC. You just have to rerun the exercise and to rerun the calculation, and the program will rewrite the output files that were wrong. So no problem for that. I was saying you don't need to be so now the program is terminated regularly. Okay. So here we have the total magnetization, that is 3. CF.in is another file. Is obviously a calculation that regards cobalt. So in the calculation is different. We have a different, first of all, we have a different element. So we have cobalt instead of iron. The structure has two atoms, so you have two atoms. It's an HCP structure, and you have so you have a different different atomic structures, two atoms, and just it. So for the rest, the calculation is similar to before. And okay, now we have run the self-consistent calculation, and again we run the non-self-consistent calculation as before. So the calculation is finished. Let's just check that it's finished as well. Now, now we can run the DOS calculation. So the command is as usual, sorry, the command is wrong. So the command is as usual, remote MPI run, if you are using the cluster. The command is dos.x, and then the input of the file is co.dos.in. Yes, majority in the end zone means the spin up state is the same thing. I mean, up and down is just as we were saying that.
Why is just the nomenclature doesn't matter?
It's a difference. And for Ignacio Martino Agliati, I think that this is a thing that that you need to see in the exercise and see what happens if you can measure the crystal field to estimate the crystal field splitting. You can look at what happens at what happens at the two the extrema of you can plot. You can, for example, project T2G and EG with the broch WFC and see if the distance between the two is changed or not. You can see how you can see what happens, but I think that okay, for collinear versus non-collinear calculation, yes, the same thing, and I will show you just after, and just afterwards, just in, I think that I will just do cobalt now, and then we'll pass to the bands done with collinear and non-collinear to see how it works, and that's that. Okay, now we have, we can collect again the DOS file. So it's passing from HPC code or DOS like this. Yeah, now the DOS file, if you open the DOS file, we look. So the value of the Fermi level that is of 18.82, you can plot. We can plot the density of states. As you can see now, the structure is different. And the electronic structure is different for cobalt. We have that. The crystal field splitting actually in this case is much smaller, and so you have that all the that the cobalt is nice, you know, it's it has all the majority channel occupied while the minority channel is partially occupied, and you have the you have an exchange splitting of of 2.1 electron volts. We can now run the PDOS calculation, the projected DOS calculation. We can use a number of processors of 8, so we can just run like this. So the program is projwfc.x. The input file is copdos.in. And for those using the cluster, specify a number of processors that is not 20, but less than 28 is okay. And we can run it like this. You have Joseph Anis, you have two atoms in the unit cell, it's right, but the two atoms are the same species, as you can see. Okay, I can just in the meantime that the calculation runs, I can show you. So if okay, so you have you're right, you have two atoms, but you have only one type of atom. So both atoms have the same label. So you see here, you have the first atom as label CO, cobalt. The second atom has the same label. The atomic species are specified here. So there's a list with all the atomic species. And there's only cobalt that is associated to given to this file, to this pseudo potential file. So the calculation, so you need to specify only one starting magnetization because you have only one species. The starting magnetization is not for each atom in the atomic position card, but is for each species identified in atomic species here. So let's see if it's finished. Okay, so we can retrieve HPC. Okay, just let's scroll to the bottom of the file where you can find the analysis of the loading charges. That's in this case is what we are interested in. So you have that. Lower the character, otherwise it's not possible to fit all the data here. So can you see, so you, in this case you have two atoms, so you have the loading charges for two atoms. Obviously the system is completely symmetric between the two atoms, so they are completely equal. What you can see is that the occupancy of the up channel is 4.66, so it's almost completely filled by, almost completely occupied. The occupation of each of all the orbitals is larger than 0.9, so it's like all the up channel is in this case occupied, while instead the minority channel is occupied only partially, even if all the orbitals are partially occupied. And so you have that are partially occupied. And the total magnetization, per ion, as according to the loading charge, the total contribution to the magnetization from each atom is 1.66. Each atom. So the total magnetization is something like 3.7, but each atom contributes with 1.66. The other thing that you can notice is that in this case you have that actually the polarization of the D channel is larger than the total polarization, because you have that the p orbitals contribute with a negative value. So the p orbitals contribute to have a, give a negative contribution to the magnetization. Okay, there was another part of the exercises where you had to compute these values integrating the partial density of states. But we will skip it and pass to the fourth exercise. It is the if you want follow the exercise. The exercise, there are the instructions in the MD file that you can find there. Okay, this is the last exercise. And the last exercise is about plotting the bands. If one wants to plot the bands for a magnetic system.
So Pietro, this is very tricky, so quite slow, so that people...
Okay, if you want to plot the bands for a magnetic system. Okay. There are two cases. Okay, we consider two cases. One is the collinear case, and the other one is the non-collinear case. For the non-collinear case, the only difficulty is that you have to family of bands. So obviously, as before, we are using the case of nickel in this case. As before, the first ingredient for computing the bands is having a charge density. So what we have to do is to compute the charge density for our system. We do as usually in the same way, pw.x minus mk10, and we specify the input file. So I'm running the self-consistent calculation. So the program is PW. I'm setting up the 10 the parallelization of key points with 10 with nk equal 10, because I'm running in the cluster. So as we have 20 processors, the better way to exploit them is to increase as much as possible the parallelization of key points. And the input file that I'm using is me.scf.in. I submit the calculation. Okay, in the meantime that it runs, we just look and the input file. As the input file is as before. The only difference is that now nickel is also not, is another starch, is a different structure. It's different from cobalt and from iron as well. So it has an FCC structure, one atom per cell. And just that we are using a collinear spin polarized calculation. So we specify in spin equal to a starting magnetization equal to 0.7. For the rest, the calculation is a regular calculation. We have only one atom per cell. And we are using a 14 times 14 times 14 mesh. We check if the calculation has finished. We just check that the calculation has succeeded. And we recover the output file. You can open the file with the command that you wish. It has succeeded. Okay, in this case, we won't run the DOS calculation, even if to have a very accurate value of the Fermi level, maybe it would be better, but we will use this value of the Fermi level, 17.8978. Now that we have run the calculation, now that we have run the self-consistent calculation, we run a non-self-consistent calculation. I first submit the calculation, then I will comment on the input file. So it's remote MP run. The program is again pw.x, but the input is one. Again, specify the input like this. So program pw.x, then specify 10, the parallelization of key points equal to 10, and specify the input file need.pand.in. We submit the calculation. Okay, the calculation is going. And in the meantime, we look at the input file. So first of all, we specify bands. Bands means that the calculation is a non-self-consistent calculation, but it's different from specifying non-self-consistent calculation because when you do a non-self-consistent calculation, the program assumes that you want to use that for performing integration for density of states or for any other properties. So all the properties will be summed in the Brillouin zone. And for these sums to be correct, and have the same, the key point mesh must have the same symmetry as the lattice, lattice that you are using. For this reason, the program, when it finds an SCF calculation, symmetrizes the mesh of key points that you've given to the program, unless you tell the program to do otherwise. But it's much simpler just to specify the bands. In this case, the program knows that you want to compute just the bands so that you are giving the key points in a format like this, for example, that is a format where you just specify a point, a set of key points that are along a path. In this case, we use the crystal B format. The crystal B format is made in this way. You just specify the number of key points, the coordinates of the key points, and then you specify another number. So the program understands that it has to create a segment of 20 key points from this value here to this value here, and adds 20 key points, and so creates 20 key points between zero from the gamma point 0, 0, 0 to the L point 5.5.5.5, and this line of 20 points is added to the list of key points that are computed by the program. It is done like this for all the key points. Eventually, when you will find that the program is using 20, 40, 20, 30, 40, 50, 70, 71 key points that are organized along this line. Let's check if the program is finished. The program is finished. This means that it's always better to check if there have been problems. So we just are seeing from HPC v.band.out. And see if the program has succeeded. It has succeeded, so we can proceed with the next step. The next step is to use the electronic structure. Okay, here we already have the eigenvalues to plot our bands. They are here. So you see, you have 271 key points. The program has already computed the key points, but it has not printed out in the output because there are too many. It has just saved them in an XML file. And now we instruct, we use another program to read them and print them in a format that is possible to plot. The program is called bands.x, as all the data are as all the data are in the remote cluster, I will execute the program remotely. So it's okay. Here there is the first. Here is the only thing that one has to take care. As I was saying, the only tricky part of this plotting the bands in for the spin polarized collinear system is that you have the set of eigenvalues for the up channel and for the down channel. And the program bands.x needs to know if you want to plot the up channel or the down channel. For this reason, there are two input files. I first submit the one for the up channel like this. In the meantime, the program computes the bands. We look at how the input of this program is done. So the input is very simple, actually. It's just, again, the prefix, the name of the file where you want the data to be printed. This is actually a prefix because the program saves a lot of files. And then the specification of the component that you want to plot, spin component equal one. Obviously, the only thing that changes for spin component, for the down component, for the down file is spin component equal two. Just check if it was finished. Yes. So as I was saying, all the files that the program creates in this case are done at this prefix. So we just recover them from the remote like this. So we put the same, so they are created all with the same name like this. We are copying the files from the remote. So the file has created three files, as you can see. One is spinup.band.data, and then the other three. We will use actually, so now we just we submit the same command for the down channel. In the meantime, we have a look to the the output file of the band program. Okay, the program, so the first important information is this one. So it's what are the isymmetry points that you are using. So here is a list of the key points. And if you want to perform a plot, these values are very useful. These values are very useful because these are the, this is the core, this is the path. This is the length along the mean. The program prints the eigenvalues using a coordinate. The coordinate that it uses is the path length between the first key point and the given key point. So this coordinate is the position in the plot of the isymmetry point. Let me explain better. Okay, we will use for plotting the bands, we will use this GNU plot script. At this point here, I need to specify what are the coordinates of the isymmetry points. And I just take the points from the bands program and I use those lengths here in order to have the correct position of the isymmetry points. Other things that are important in the output of the program are, it's the symmetry analysis. Okay, the symmetry analysis, it's quite hard to understand, but for example, for the gamma point, it's quite clear what's happening because at least it's quite, there is one thing that we can understand very easily, and there is the way to also to estimate the value of the crystal field splitting, because you have that the system as the system has the cubic symmetry, so there is the crystal field splitting that Alessandro talked about in the lecture is here, and you can see that the T2G and the EG are splitted, and that T2G are at a value of an eigenvalue of 15.39 at the gamma point, and 16.53 at the for the EG, always at the gamma point. Obviously, these this gap between the two changes if you change key point. It's also obviously here the symmetry is not exactly the same. So you can see that the fact that you are in another key point is also lifting the degeneracy between the T2G. There is a T2G that has a different value, and well, instead the other one is the other two still form a couple. And but at least at the gamma point, the symmetry analysis is easy to read, especially if one knows that, like in this case, we are looking for the T2G and the EG, and these ones are here. So now let me get back. Always better to check if it has finished. Probably it has finished. So in this case, we want to recover all the. Data for the down, and so in particular, we have retrieved from the remote these two files, NI spin down bandata.gnu and the one for the other one. This the format of these two files is done in order that can be easily read by new plot and plotted. I have already prepared the plot that hopefully it will work. Okay, you can see this is the plot of the bands. Okay, nothing spectacular, but you have in black the majority channel and in red the minority channel. And nothing else, just it. And now we want to do the same exercise in the non-collinear case. Okay. We are using the same system, so we have the same energy and synergies, and we are just using a different formalism. So we are using we are just using this yes, the same formalism as the same formalism as before. Again, we are running, we can actually, as we look at the file, we can see also that actually we are, to be faster, we are actually running the self-consistent calculation in the same way as we had run for the, so for the self-consistent calculation, I'm still using the spin polarized calculation. So I'm using and spin equal to and starting magnetization 0.7. So I can spare actually this calculation because it's already there. And I immediately execute instead the non-self-consistent calculation. In this case, in the non-self-consistent calculation, that I have specified non-colline equal true and starting magnetization 0.7. The program is able to read the spin polarized calculation and transform it in a non-collinear potential. It assumes that the magnetization is oriented along the z-axis. It has already finished, so I can. So in this case, we are doing a non-collinear calculation, and obviously we don't have anymore an up and down channel. We have only one channel. All the game values are put together, and so now we are going to use again the band program with this input. Okay, there are three the input of the program. Now there is not the spin component anymore because we don't have any spin component anymore. we are specifying a different name for the file band. And then there is this other flag here, L sigma equal true, that because we are asking the program to compute the average value of the sigma of the spin operator in the z direction. So you can specify a sigma 1 equal to a sigma 2 equal to a sigma 3 equal and sigma 3 equal true in order to get the expectation value of the spin operator of the component of the spin operator between the wave function. So we can now run the program. The program is again bounds.tix, and the input is need.bound underscore pp. I'm calling and the input is me.band dot underscore pp dot noncolin dot in. Okay, now we just we have asked the program to save all its data with the prefix me noncolin data. So now we recover these files from the remote like this. Oh, sorry. So I mistyped the command first, and so the command is rsync from HPC and then the number of the data. As you can see now, the file is produced. It produces a new file that is called me.noncolin.data.tree. If we look inside the file, we see that, okay, here the result is actually trivial because obviously all here there are printed for each of the key points, there is printed the expectation value of the spin for each of the bands. Okay, in this case, it's let's say trivial because it's either 1/2 or minus 1/2, as we expected, because we just do non-collinear calculation starting from a spin polarized calculation. So it couldn't be otherwise. Now we need to read the values that we have in this file and collect it and put them together with the data that are here. Here there are the bands, but here there are the bands, but without no information about what is the component of the spin they are, what is the expectation value of the spin operator on them. We have this information instead in this file here, but obviously, but then we need to put them together. At the moment, there is no application in Quantum Espresso that does it automatically. I have created this small this more Fortran program that does it for you. So we need just to compile the program. To compile the program, we use gFortran compiler that is in the virtual machine. So gFortran, name of the Fortran compiler, minus O dot non-Turing dot X, for example. Okay, any name is okay. You can just put any name that you want. And let's do like this. And the program has been compiled. And now, as you can see, you have the program here. And the program expects a file that is called nil.conin, that is called in this way. So here, just to copy cp nil.conin data dot tree in nil.conin dot s in this way. And then you just need to run the program in this way. And the program now, you can see, has created a file that is called mybands.data. If you look down inside mybands.data, you see that you have the same bands that you had before. So you have an expression of the bands. But you have a third column with the value of the spin expectation value. The expectation value of the Z component of the spin operator. So, okay. Now I have prepared the script for plotting the bands. It is this one. You just run like this. Okay, and this is the output. It's printing something that I don't. Ah, yeah, okay. So, so we need to add the Fermi value of the Fermi level here. Sorry, but it's really strange. Okay, as you can see now, you have values of the something went wrong with the program. I don't understand what. Okay, let me rerun everything from scratch because probably I did something wrong. So, anyway, sorry for that. So the result that we should obtain is this one. So where we have the bands that are printed at different that are printed with different colors for the up and down projection. And just that, as the file, obviously there are only minus 1/2 and plus 1/2 again values, the result is trivial. And you should get this result, but something went wrong.
Okay, never mind. Anyway, they have the reference.
Yeah.
This was the last exercise, right?
Yes, it was the last. Sorry for so it was the last exercise. And
well, anyway, they have the README file where everything is explained.
Yeah, everything is explained.
Should be able to reproduce everything in details in these tutorials. And in any case, tutors are always available. So please feel free to contact them for any issue. So even today or maybe tomorrow, I mean, they are always available during these weeks. So you can try by yourself to reproduce all the data. Of course, you know, doing that online and in real time, you know, something can happen. So, but anyway, we test everything. So there is the README file with all the details. The results are collected in the slides. So please try yourself and anything that you need, you can ask the tutors or any one of us.
Okay, so this is the last exercise and thank you for your attention. And
so, okay, thank you very much, Pietro, for this very, very long tutorial with all these.
Sorry, it's just that.
Yeah, it's fine. I mean, quite detailed. And so maybe we can collect one or two questions from the audience online, Zoom, if there are any questions.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, well, if not, I think we can close. So Samira. Samira wants to ask something.
Sir, good morning, sir.
Yes, please.
It's not a question, it's just a remark. If about the HPC, when you do a calculation and running after the Hansa, sometimes we need more time. And about the HPC, it closed at 3 a.m., I think.
He's asking about when is the ACP cluster available? I mean,
HCP
what time?
Okay, I think that all the HCP clusters, all the HCP HPC clusters are available up to, okay, CISA cluster is available up to 8, is always available. There is a reservation with 40 nodes, from 10 to 2, and then there is a reservation of 10 nodes from 2 to 8.
Yes, but yes, the last day it will be Friday, and how we will do for the exercise of Friday? The HPC system still working in the weekend to do the exercise, or it will be closed on Friday? Because Friday we have class with you all day.
Friday, I think it will. Friday, the exercises will be done on the AIDA platform, so they won't be done on the HPC cluster. For what concern, I don't know the other clusters. For what concerns HPC cluster in CISA, Friday is available with the reservation out of lecture with the reduced nodes, but you can still submit the calculation and do the calculation. You can do the calculation at any time, but during the night there is no reservation, so you go in queue with the other users of the cluster. But usually for small runs there is no problem. So small runs can run. You have maybe just wait 30 minutes, but during the night, I think it's not an issue if you just submit the calculation and wait for the morning after to have it. And during the day, the reservation is available for with a reduced number of nodes, but I think that they should be at least. And then if I am, I don't know the other clusters.
Yes, my question was about the last, only the, about the last day, because maybe we need more time to do the running, because Friday it finished at afternoon, and
Paul, you want to say something?
Yes, concerning the Arnes cluster, so it is available all the time.
Yes.
Up to Wednesday midnight, because on Thursday and Friday different clusters will be used. But if there is a wish that Arnes cluster would be available, let's say up to the end of the weekend or so, I can make a request to try to extend for a few more days with a smaller number of reserved nodes. And so I can give you the information whether I got extension, let's say, tomorrow.
Yes, thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Okay, so I think we can close this long session from this morning. So I really thank Pietro for this exercise and the explanations. And I thank all the attendees of today. So for any questions, you feel free to ask in Slack channel or even YouTube. So thank you very much to all of you. See you tomorrow.
See you tomorrow.
Thank you.
Bye-bye. Thank you.
Bye.